So I've been playing recently with some ESP32 S3 chips and boards. So this board is a tiny S3 from the Unexpected Maker. It's a well-known fact that the S3 doesn't have a DAC converter. There's lots of complaints online about how that's really annoying and you can't get audio out, how frustrating. But it may surprise you to see, if we switch over to the oscilloscope, that we have what very much looks like an analog signal. And if we zoom out on this analog signal, you can see that it looks remarkably like an audio waveform. So that's pretty interesting. If we turn on channel 1, which is connected directly to pin 21 on the board, we can see how this works. So we're using a PDM signal. So if I zoom in on that signal, you can actually see how the density changes as the value of the analog signal changes. So to reconstruct the analog signal, all I've got is a simple RC filter. So if we look back at the board, you can see my RC filter here. And I picked fairly arbitrary components for this. I think this is just a 1K and 100 nanofarad. But it's reconstructing the analog signal, no problem. So let's have a listen to it and see how it sounds. So I have a very simple speaker here, USB powered speaker. And this just connects via a headphone jack. So let's get that wired up and see if we can actually hear the audio signal. So we'll plug that in and we'll take our reconstructed analog signal from the RC filter. We'll just play that on tip. And of course we do need a ground signal. Surprisingly it's working without one, which is interesting. But let's connect ground up as well. So there we go. So we have ground properly wired up. So that's our reconstructed audio signal. But what's really interesting is that we can actually take the signal directly from pin 21. So the raw PDM signal, if we feed that straight into our amplifier, we still get perfectly good audio. So what's happening here is the bandwidth of the analog amplifier in this speaker is low enough that it's filtering out all of the PDM noise and reconstructing our signal. Now what's really interesting as well is we can actually just drive headphones directly from the PDM signal. So I've got some headphones here. So let's plug these cheap headphones in. So what should happen is the headphones also have a limited bandwidth, so the small speakers in the headphones can't amplify the noise from the PDM signal, so they'll just filter out the audio signal. So I'll put this close to the microphone, and hopefully that's near enough the microphone that you can hear it. And it's surprisingly good quality. Now, what's quite interesting as well, I keep saying what's quite interesting, but it is all very interesting, is how simple you can make an amplifier. So if you think about Class D amplifiers, they're just simple switches, and they use a similar idea to the PDM signal, where the speaker is just switched very quickly, and you get sound generated. So let's hook up the ground wire for this. And all I've got here is a MOSFET acting as a switch, and it's just switching this speaker on and off very quickly. So pretty simple, not much going on there. Let's plug in the PDM signal directly to the gate of the MOSFET. So there we go. It's reproducing the audio. It's not fantastic quality, but that's not really surprising. This MOSFET is not a logic level MOSFET. I'm actually surprised it works at all. So that's pretty good. So now feels like an opportune moment to mention PCBWay. So I've got some new boards from them, the ESP32 TV board version 3. So I've just been testing these. I fixed the previous mistake, so now battery charging does work. I've also fixed the issue where the USB controller was conflicting with the ESP32. So that now works really well, getting really good speeds on the SD card. So that's great. Need to do a bit more testing, solder on the display and make sure that works. But that should give us some really interesting results. So let's have a look at what's going on under the hood. So here's our original waveform. So let's play that. And I've plotted the spectrogram just for reference so we can see what that should look like. So we'll close this waveform. And what I've done is I've simulated a delta sigma modulation of that waveform. So we can have a look at this. So this data up here, the blue data, is all of the samples, and they're just going from -1 to 1. And then underneath we have the spectrogram. So I've currently got it set to go from 0 to 500 kilohertz, because the sample rate of this signal is around 1 megahertz. So let's change the spectrogram settings to just do up to 8 kilohertz. So we'll change this to 8 kilohertz. And now if you look here, you can see that right at the bottom of our spectrum, we have the original signal. So all we need to do to recover our original data is to low-pass filter it. So let's do that. So we go here, and we'll go low-pass filter, and we'll filter it at 8 kHz. So let's apply that. And there we go. We have our original signal recovered. So let's play this. That's pretty good. We've managed to recover our original signal from the delta sigma modulated data. So what's quite interesting, if I undo that low pass filter, so we go back to our delta sigma modulated data, and then hit play, we actually can hear the original data as well. So what's happening here is the audio system on my Mac can only play up to around 20 kilohertz maximum. So all of the higher frequencies are being filtered out automatically. So it's pretty interesting. I think it's a very cool piece of technology. So how do we actually do this in code? The documentation on the Expressive website is surprisingly good. They've even got an example circuit for doing a low pass filter to recover the original signal. It's certainly more sophisticated than my simple RC filter. They've got some example code for generating a 100 hertz sine wave. Looking at this code, we can see that they are using a timer to output the samples. Now this is perfectly reasonable, but it does mean that our code will be constantly interrupted to output a sample. I have implemented this for outputting audio, and it does work without any issues. But wouldn't it be nice if we could use the I2S peripheral to do all the heavy lifting? Now the I2S peripheral does support PDM output, but there's a slight wrinkle. It always outputs the right and left channel, and wants to have a pin allocated to the clock signal. Now my workaround for this is to just output the same value for both the left and the right samples. That way we can just take the output of the I2S peripheral and treat it as a mono signal. The only other slight annoyance is the clock signal. In my experiments I just set this to an unused pin. GPIO 45 or 46 are quite good candidates for this, as on the S3 they can't really be used for anything else. GPIO 0 could also be a good option. Now you may be asking, what took me on this path in the first place? Why did I start playing around with PDM output? Well, I've been getting my TV code working on the tiny watch from Unexpected Maker. This has a really small buzzer and a very simple driver circuit, but in theory, it should work with PDM data. And it does. It's just very, very quiet.